Robertson scored the goal. That's the latest. I'm Elizabeth Secker.
Callan FM on 105 FM. Community radio at its best.
Brace yourself. It's Andy Snowden. Stage and stage and stage and screen.
Go ahead, make my day.
Mrs. Robinson, you're trying to seduce me.
And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
You ever seen a grown man naked?
Here's Johnny.
Life is a box of chocolates, almost. You never know what you're gonna get.
Tell me about it, Stir.
Stage and screen.
It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show.
Yes, indeed, it is I, Andy Snowden, with music from stage and screen and anything you might have seen on your television box. Let me just keep you up to date with the scores on the doors over there at Goodison Park with the biggest match this season between Everton and Liverpool. Well, I say the biggest match for Everton and Liverpool. It's Everton 1, Liverpool 1. And as I say, you're listening to the Stage and Screen Show with me, Andy Snowden, here each and every Saturday here on 105 Callon FM. And back in July, Artistic Director of Theatre Clwyd, Tamara Harvey, came on the Stage and Screen Show to explain the heartbreaking decision to postpone this year's pantomime. The Rock and Roll Panto is a regular, popular fixture at Theatre Clwyd for many years, and this is the first time in living memory that it's been cancelled. However, not to be beaten, Tamara contacted the playwright and Theatre Clwyd favourite actor Christian Patterson to see if they could come up with something, just something that could save Christmas for their audiences. And the result is the panto that never nearly was. And its creator, Christian Patterson, joins me now on Zoom from South Wales.
Hello!
How are you, mate? Lovely.
I'm all right. How are you?
Hey, fantastic. Hey, thanks for doing this. I really appreciate it.
Pleasure. No problem at all.
Wonderful. Christian, it's been a funny old year, hasn't it? It's been horrendous, especially for artists and actors and anybody basically that works in the theatre. But on a personal level, how's it been for you?
I think it would be fair to say lots of ups and downs. As a family, we've been really, really enjoying being together all the time because I'm off doing a project, or Michelle's off doing a project, and you know, we don't see each other really other than the weekends and things. So it came as a bit of a shock that, you know, all my work got cancelled apart from the panto. The panto only got cancelled a couple of weeks ago. Everything got cancelled within a space of a couple of weeks, which was really weird because I was supposed to start work just after lockdown hit, and I was supposed to work straight the way through until January the 2nd of next year. So everything got cancelled, and it was a real shock. Then we discovered that, you know, oh, how lovely it is to spend time with each other. Yeah. And then we thought, you know, hold on a minute, it's lovely to spend time with each other, but we haven't got any money coming in.
Yeah.
And, you know, there was all that stuff with Rishi Sunak giving help to the people who were out of employment because of the virus. But every time he announced something like that, he wouldn't say anything about the self-employed.
Yeah.
And that seemed to come like 2 weeks later and 2 weeks later again and all sorts of stuff. But, you know, they did, you know, give us a bit of financial existence, but not enough, obviously, but nobody's on enough, so it's not, you know, it's not me complaining. I'm kind of grateful that we've had this time together, but I'm also chomping at the bit now to go, when will normality resume? Mm. And Andy, a lot of performers like myself, I think, will be thinking, I hate this term, by the way, but this new normal, but what is the new normal going to be for me as a performer? You know, I had... touch wood. Pretty good career, really. I was, you know, doing a lot of London theatre and touring and at Cloyd, obviously, and everyone knows what that venue means to me. And also at Stoke. But who knows what happens after this, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know whether or not careers for anyone will be the same after this. And you just have to do what you can to get through it and see where it lands. But it doesn't help when Sunak says stuff like, you know, well, you know, the Lovies have to retrain. And you think,
I know.
That really grated me.
Yeah.
That really grated
me. I know.
Because I just think, you know, I just think, why don't you truly train?
Exactly. You know what I mean? Exactly. But I think the arts and sports as well, sports people, they've been hit the hardest. And I think people kind of sort of go, oh, well, let's not worry about them. I mean, you know, there's a lot more, you know, more things to worry about in the world. But it's more, for me, it's more the confusion of everything. I mean, you've written a production for Theatre Clwyd that, in effect, you can do all that work. It could be rehearsed. And then on a whim, sort of nonchalantly, they could just say, oh, it's not happening now. You can't do it.
Yeah. Tamara tried the damnedest with Beauty and the Beast. You know, she was determined for it to go ahead. Really determined. And then, you know, it just wasn't possible. And then about 3 or 4 weeks later, she said to me, you know, I have to do something. So what can we do? And I came up with the idea of Panther That Nearly Never Was. I mean, how ironic will it be if the Panther That Nearly Never Was isn't?
You know? Yeah.
So, you know, it is quite hard to, it's hard to plan anything, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. And I was quite impressed the other day when and I was watching your In Conversation with Tamara, and that's the artistic director of Theatre Clwyd, of course, Tamara Harvey, and Phil Harris, the legendary dame of Theatre Clwyd. And you're not just somebody that likes panto, not somebody that sort of like dabbles at it. You are a scholar of the whole art of pantomime, aren't you? You know the history and everything.
Yeah, I find it all-encompassing. I find it really, really interesting because it tracks a great path. If you go backwards through it, the path is like extraordinary, you know, because you start to go through the legends, really, of British variety. You know, people like, for example, Les Dawson, who I was very lucky enough to see play Dame in Babes of the Wood in Swansea, who was extraordinary. And then you go through the likes of Frankie Howard and Tommy Cooper, Tommy Trinder, all these big names, Spike Milligan, all these massive, massive names. And one of my heroes, the wonderful Harry Secombe, obviously. You go through all these names and then you start to go back further and further and further to people like Little Titch, Mary Lloyd, all those. It strips right back to the 1700s, you know, as I was saying. 1700 was when the first panto was done at Drury Lane, and it was Mother Goose and the Harlequin. So, you know, I find the entire thing really fascinating, and I'm kind of dedicated to it. But as I said in that conversation, you know, there was an actor who said to me that if I wanted to be taken seriously as an actor, then I had to stop doing panto, which I think is utter rubbish. Because, you know, audiences, certainly at Theatre Clwyd, will have seen me in things like Glengarry Glen Ross or Aristocrats or Rip the Fair Country. And so, you know, I'm a classically trained actor, but I think, you know, panto allows you to stretch muscles that you maybe wouldn't if you were just doing a play.
But I think if pantomime is taken as seriously as any other production, then I think it shows, and it's a great night out. But you can always tell the people who have kind of gone, it's almost like an end of term blowout. You know, and you can tell if a pantomime is great, and you can tell if it's been, you know, just a money making exercise at the end of the year.
Yeah, because, you know, I've been to see people in panto that really know how to do their craft, and you sit there and go, wow, look at that person, absolutely exceptional. And I've been to see the big names who are at the top of the bill, that at the top of the wage link, they're in the area for 5 or 6 weeks, then they're gone.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
And there's a massive difference. You know, looking, you know, when you talk about Theatre Clwyd, for example, and you look at Phil Harris and Dan Lloyd, for example, right?
Yeah.
They're not household names, but people go to see them at Theatre Clwyd every single year because they're a panto pull.
Yeah.
They put themselves at the top of a Christmas tree and you know, people want to see them. Yeah. Same thing happens at Stoke with Johnny and myself. Okay, Johnny is more of a household name, but we have people coming to see it because they want to come and see us.
Yeah.
And then you've got people like Sean Jones, you know, who I directed in Wave Me Goodbye, who used to be at Rill and now has moved to New Brighton, you know. The audience are really loyal to that person because there's a safe feeling with them and an unsafe feeling with them.
Yeah.
You know they're going to go off that script and be a little bit cheeky.
Exactly.
And you were there that night. Do you know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean. And like some of the things that you were talking about the other night in your conversation, I said to my wife, I went, I was there that night. Yeah. I can remember it happening. Those moments of going off the script are, as Phil said, you know, a good ad-lib is a well-rehearsed ad-lib. You know, you would never know if it was written or not with Phil.
No, and that's the thing. You look at people like Morecambe and Wise, or you look at people like Frankie Howard and Leonard Rossiter, for example. All of that stuff that they do was rehearsed to within an inch of its life. All the little, Mrs. Erda, or you know, all that sort of stuff. It's really, really, really carefully rehearsed. The brilliance of it is they make it look it was like it was the first time. Morecambe and Wise's rehearsal period was you know, just so focused. Ernie Wise being one of the best straight men and a ranked straight man in my mind, really. And Eric Morecambe, of course, being one of the funniest men I think that's ever taken a breath. But, you know, the minutiae of what they're doing, what they're saying, all so well scripted, mostly by Eddie Braeburn, so well scripted. And then the little bit of extra on top is the magic that they bring.
Yeah.
And Dan and Phil and Emmy and Alice and Pete and the wonderful Luke Thornton, you know, all the Linwyn, they all bring the extra bit of magic to my script. They dress it up.
Yep.
And I'm not a precious writer, you know. If I didn't trust the performer, I might be a little bit more precious. But with someone like the people that I've mentioned, and in particular with Dan and Phil, you just go, just run with it, lads.
Yeah.
You'll know when you've run out of steam, and then just come back to the story.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely. It was only a few months ago that there was an announcement at Theatre Clue that they weren't going to go ahead with their pantomime. And although we've got this this new piece, which we'll talk about in a moment, but what was that phone call to get the phone call from Tamara to say, we can't do it? It's a stab in the heart, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It was absolutely heartbreaking. And because Tamara herself had decided to direct the panto, and she spoke a little bit during the webcast the other day about how, you know, her views on panto were so changed, and she's now so passionate about it, and, you know, wanted to bring this massive piece of magic to people and bring her own take on it and things. And the script's ready, and the design's ready, everything's ready, the technical stuff is ready, the music's ready, everything was ready to go. And to hear her voice, well, she rang up and she went, hello, mister. And I just, from that, thought, we're not going anything to pull it, you know. And she said, this is the call that I never wanted to make, you know. And I said, all right, okay. And we sort of commiserated with each other for about half an hour and you know, devised that it would go ahead in 21-22, season 21-22, as opposed to year 21.
I won't be there then.
And I thought, well, okay, you know, we'll see the light of day and things. And it was very, very hard. And I suppose I grasped onto the Stoke panto even harder than I really suppose, thinking, you know, well, hopefully that'll go ahead. And we were kept told by the producers that it was their intention to go ahead no matter what. And then about 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, maybe, we had the call from them to say it wasn't possible for them to continue either. So, yeah, it's a really demoralising and unstable position to be in. But, you know, there is a little light at the end of the tunnel, as you say, with a new thing that's happening.
Yeah. Now, because Tamara kind of, like any good mother, she said, right, we're not doing that, but we will do something. And so we're all sort of grasping at straws and thinking, oh, great, because all I want to do, really, you know, it doesn't really matter what it is. I want to do what I normally do around about that time of year. And now you've written this new play. And is it literally written from scratch, this?
Yeah. Tamara rang me and said, she had sort of like ideas of going, right, okay, let's do like Christmas carols, little Christmas stories, poems maybe, and mince pies, all that sort of stuff. And then I think she just thought, oh, we just need a laugh. We need a real laugh, you know. So she rang me, she said, do you think you can write like an hour piece that's panto-esque and blah? And I said, yeah, I think I can really, you know. And I thought, well, Beauty and the Beast almost made it to the stage this year. It will make it to the stage next year, hopefully. But what about the panto that nearly never was, you know? So basically, the premise of it is that there isn't supposed to be a panto this year, and that there's no mention of COVID, there's no mention of the pandemic, there's nothing of that. But let's just have an hour and 10 minutes without it, shall we? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can't turn the radio on, open the paper, and you can't sit down with your friends without either one of you going, you know, oh God, no, yeah, I was going to do this, but
yeah.
So we're not having any of that. We're not having any of that at all. So our take on it is that the baddies have won, and there wasn't going to be a Christmas. And then the baddie goes, oh my God, if there isn't a Christmas, why am I here? Type thing, you know.
Yeah.
And that's the premise of the entire story. But it was great fun to write. It took 3 weeks of like literally starting work at 9:30, having a cup of tea, starting work at 9:30, working till 6:30 with an hour off in the middle for, but it was a real labor of love and going, okay. So I've got, Tamara said, of the 10 people that were going to do panto, 6 feel safe and able to come here and do it. So I had 6 characters. There's not going to be much in terms of, you know, people to offstage do quick changes. Okay, so how do I deal with that and all sorts of stuff? And, you know, not many locations. So I thought, okay, well, maybe they're in the area of Nearly Neverland, where nearly nothing never happens. And then they go to nowhere. So, you know, it's a peculiar little piece, but it's, make no bones about it, it's panto.
Right, and is there a reason, a logistical reason why it only lasts an hour?
Well, because basically it's a big risk to put it on, a massive, massive risk. And they've done the very lovely thing of going, all the tickets are one price, you know, which is great.
Yeah.
So it was felt that to do a full scale panto, well, we might as well have done Beauty and the Beast, but we can't have all the technical crew backstage. We can't have all the dressers backstage. We can't have 10 people in the cast. We can't. So, you know, everything was going, okay, this needs to scale down, scale down, scale down, scale down. So eventually we just went, well, what can we do? And this is what we could do. But, you know, it's interesting for me because I've never written, I think it's about an hour and 10, but I've never written an hour story from beginning to end. And I kind of felt like when I'd written it, I thought, this will have another life, this. You know, because it's nice for, you could do it with 5 people as opposed to 6, but I've written it for 6. Because one character could definitely double. But it's just an hour of, it's a variety show for an hour.
Yeah.
You know, with wonderful, wonderful characters, and the people that are coming back to do it are absolutely great. So it's just exciting, really, for me.
Theatre Clue is famous for its rock and roll pantomime. Is it going to be a rock and roll full-on gig like that?
Yes, as much as it can be, of course, because it can only be 6 people on the stage, so there'll be how many instruments those people can play. They're going to have to be socially distanced, so that's going to be interesting. But yeah, it's going to keep the rock and roll theme with it, yeah.
Right.
The songs and stuff haven't been finalised yet, so I can't talk too much about them because Tayo does. I tend to put the songs in the script, and then Tayo goes, "Yeah, that's a good one. No, we'll take that out and replace it with whatever, you know." So I can't really talk about the music yet. But if 80% of the music that I suggested goes in, I think, you know, I'll enjoy myself.
And are you always writing in your head? Are you, because I remember talking to you, I'm going to hit you with one of your own jokes here, and I I saw your dick a couple of years ago. Hey. And Dick Whittington up at Theatre Clwyd, and straight afterwards when I interviewed you, and you were already talking about next year's show, you wanted to do Mother Goose, and not only that, you had jokes written in your head just from watching what we just watched. Is that always constantly going on in your head?
It's a nightmare in my head. it's an absolute nightmare. You don't want to live in my head, I'm telling you now. Because literally, you know, I hear a joke and I think, ooh, that's good. That's good. I tell you, that character, it'd be great to say that to that character and stuff like that. And, you know, basically, it's constantly ticking over in my brain. I think, ultimately, what it is that I'm probably a really frustrated stand-up comedian. I don't think I'd be able to do stand-up comedy. I watch these people and I think I'm phenomenal fans of stand-up comedians. But, you know, I think it's like, especially when I come to write the Dames comic piece or the comedy slot for the main character and stuff like that. You know, I hear my delivery of it and then I hand it over and hear somebody else's delivery of it and it gets quite exciting.
Yeah.
And I think for me, yeah, I mean, life's bloody serious. It's a serious, serious thing, life. And I think you have to be able to see the funny side of things to just get through it. So I guess I see the light in a lot of situations and I make light, even if it's to myself or in my brain, of a lot of situations. And I find that gags maketh the man.
Yeah, I know what you mean. And it's horrendous as well, because I always think, I mean, for the average man like me, you will hear a joke and you'll think, oh, I'll tell that later in the pub. And you'll get to the pub and you'll forget it.
Yeah, so absolutely.
You must always have to kind of go, I'm going to tell that joke, so I better write it down, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. My book is not as massive as Phil Harris, but, you know, I write down gags that I like and things and think, oh yeah, I'll use that at some point. And also, I write backup gags, because there's sometimes where you go, yeah, that didn't land, that gag. Phil rang me at, just before Christmas and said, do you know that gag? I said, hey, it's not landing like it should. Have you got anything else? So I reeled off a couple of gags and he went, I'm going to try that one. Ran me back the next day. Yeah, sorted, boy. No problem whatsoever. It's all done, you know.
Fantastic.
But I love it. I love it. Yeah. I really hope that my brain doesn't cease one day to take in the gags, because I'm in trouble then.
Yeah.
I'm in big trouble then, you know.
Yeah. And yeah, God, I hope that never happens as well. But you've touched on it a little bit there. You do the Theatre Clwyd pantomime, you write it, but you've got the Stoke one with Johnny Wilkes, which you've done for the last 7 or 8 years, is it?
14.
14? Sorry. Yeah. Terrible research on my part.
13 at Stoke, and we had 1 year where they got another name in and another production company. And so ATG and First Family moved us to Aylesbury. So we called it Stoke on Tour. And we had a lovely time down there, but we did Dick Whittington down there, and we'd done that the previous year. But it was the first year when we went to Aylesbury where I was writing it and I was directing it and I was in it. So we were able to let loose a little more, shall we?
Yes.
Mind you, not that Johnny and myself need any encouraging to let loose.
but you're big friends, aren't you? Family friends. I mean, you go away and everything. It's like
we've been to Florida together as families and things, and we're constantly, you know, in each other's houses. When this lockdown is over, I'll be up to see him. He'll be down and things. And we're big mates. And also, we've been talking with, I don't know how or when this will come off, but we've been having conversations with Stephen Malhern, who is a good friend of Johnny's, mm-hmm. about projects that we can do together, you know, that I can write and the three of us could be in. So, you know, Johnny opens a fair amount of doors and goes, oh, Christian will write that. And then, of course, I sit here and think, oh, I've got to write it. But, you know, touch wood so far, you know, I'm okay. It's coming out the thing, so.
Right. Oh, one last thing. I mean, he organises the UNICEF football match every other year. Have you never been interested in that?
I've been to a couple of them. I don't think he gets the credit that he deserves. Robbie always gets it. And to be honest with you, I'll tell you and your listeners now, it was Johnny's idea, the soccer aid. It was Johnny's idea. And, you know, obviously Robbie said, we'll do it together. And, you know, with his profile, you get it on and stuff like that. But I personally think that Johnny should have an MBE, an OBE. I think he should be knighted. You know, the 50 million, nearly 60 million raised for UNICEF. And he's a great, great ambassador. And he does the same thing for the Don Louise Trust. He works very hard for my charity, the Harris Fund, you know. I don't think he's given the credit he deserves. And he would never publicise it himself because he's just not that type of person.
Christian, as normal, it's an absolute treat to speak to you, mate. Thanks ever so much for that.
Andy, I'm going to miss seeing you and Rebecca on the first night.
Well, are you coming up for it?
Well, I will be there. Are you there?
Well, I hope. Drag me away if you can.
Hey, listen, I'll be there. And because I brought Dylan to the first night of Jack of the Beanstalk, so Michelle missed it completely last year. So hopefully as a family of three, we'll be there to watch it.
Yeah, brilliant. She's great. Yes, she's fine. She's working, actually. She's the only one in the family with a proper job.
So is my son. He's training to be a bricklayer. And Michelle and myself are sat in there looking for things to do. He's out laying bricks. Yeah. Well, hopefully I'll see you at press night then.
Yes, yes, definitely. And we won't even be able to shake hands.
I'm going to forgo it, Andy. I'm going to forgo it. We're going to have a hug. We might have to put a mask on, but we'll hug, man. No way. I'm not having it.
Oh, mate, it's been an absolute treat to speak to you. Thanks ever so much for that. When does it open at Theatre Square, by the way?
13th of December.
Oh, right, day after my birthday.
There we are, look. There you go. It's doing the run that I was supposed to do, because our run in Stoke is a lot shorter. So it's doing the run that I was supposed to do, which is 13th of December until the 2nd of Jan.
Right.
So it's doing the exact same run.
Fantastic. Love speaking to you, mate.
And you.
Yeah, see you soon.
All right. Take care, lovely man.
Cheers, buddy.
See ya.
Ta-da, mate. Ta-da.
Bon Jovi.
Brilliant, that. I absolutely love that. Got to be honest, the lyrics are a bit sketchy, but he's not the only one, is he? He's not the only one that's been working hard during lockdown. From the album 2020, there you are. And the other person that's been working really hard, of course, is Christian Patterson, who has penned an hour or so long play, a pantomime for Theatre Clwyd. It is called The Panto That Never Nearly Was, and that is opening in Theatre Clwyd. Christian says the 13th of December. The website says something different, but if you would like to try and get yourself some tickets, and I've got to be honest, as you would imagine, they are selling very, very fast. There are almost 5, 6 shows that have not sold out. but the webpage is theatreclwyd.com/events, and it's called The Panto That Never Nearly Was. Or you can ring the box office 01352 344101. That's 01352 344101. And also, as well, I would just like to mention this, that Sam Freeman from Theatre Clwyd contacted me the other day, and he said, could you give this a mention? Theatre Clwyd has launched a new fundraising appeal to help support creative industry freelancers. It's called the Helping Hand Appeal, and will provide an additional 50 micro bursaries for creative industry freelancers across the UK and Wales who may need extra help during the pandemic. So if you are a fan of theatre, and presumably nearly everybody that listens to this show is, being the stage and screen show here on Calon FM, and you feel, I mean, obviously we're all struggling at this present time, but if you feel that you can throw a few pounds to Theatre Clwyd's brand new fundraising appeal called the Helping Hand Appeal, same address, theatreclwyd.com, go there and you will get the details on how you can help out the freelancers. Bear in mind, nearly every single person that works in a theatre is a freelancer. You've got to bear that in mind, from the actors down to almost everybody that works on a show at a theatre. So, if they disappear, then theatres will be gone forever. The Panto That Never Nearly Was is going to be opening at Theatre Clwyd in December. Box office number 01352 344101.
Get your tickets, kids.
It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show.